Good afternoon, everyone. On behalf of British Council Armenia, I would like to warmly welcome you who are present here, as well as everyone who's watching us online through live streaming, to our 2016 Teacher Development Signature event. Thank you so much for making time to come quite early, and more importantly, with happy faces. Thank you so much. As you know, this is the fourth consecutive year that we are holding this event as part of our mission to support widespread English language teaching in Armenia, as well as support our teachers in their professional development. And I'm truly glad that this event is every year getting bigger and bigger and more impactful. Can you raise your hand if you were present yesterday in the first session? Wow. Very nice. Very nice. Welcome back. But just to let you know, this year we had the largest number of registrations, and more welcomingly, we have participants from our neighboring countries, including Iran. Where are you? Please welcome them. From Russia, Georgia, one person, very brave person. And Singapore. Where are you? Over there, back there. And as I said, many are watching us live online through the live streaming. So very welcome to this session, and hope you're going to enjoy it. As you know, this session, we are hosting the one and only Mr. Scott Thornbury. And he has kindly accepted our invitation to visit Armenia and share his knowledge and expertise in the field. I know that most of you are quite familiar with him and his work, but I'm very honored and privileged to introduce him very briefly. So Scott Thornbury has an MA TEFL from the University of Reading and is currently curriculum coordinator on the MA TESOL program at the New School in New York. His previous experience includes teaching and teacher training in Egypt, UK, Spain, and his native New Zealand. He has written over a dozen journal articles and books on such diverse subjects as voice setting phonology, corpus linguistics, speaking instruction, learner autonomy, ELT materials, educational technology, and embodied learning, a lot of stuff actually, and two of these, natural grammar and teaching unplugged, the topic of today's session, have won the British Council's ELTON Award for Innovation, which is the top award in the industry, by the way. Today in his first session, Scott is going to introduce us to Dogme language teaching approach, which he has co-developed actually. And this approach focuses on meaningful interaction and emergent language over prepared materials and following explicit syllabus. Now, before we start the session, I'm going to kindly ask you to turn off your mobile phones or put them on silent, not to cause any distractions. And please join me to welcome Scott to the stage. Enjoy it.
Thank you. Thank you, Adam. Thank you very much, and I'm so pleased to see such a great turnout on this. You should be outside. It's the most beautiful weather out there. And I'm so lucky and privileged to be here in Armenia for the first time and having this wonderful, almost autumnal weather. So anyway, it's great that you're here. Welcome back, those of you who were at the session last night. As I said yesterday, it's not five concurrent sessions that are dependent or interdependent sessions. They are each independent, but they are linked, as we'll see, and there'll be a little bit of repetition, forgive me. So, we've got an hour and a quarter. I'm going to allow some time for questions, I hope, if we get through it. And this is really a workshop, so I'm having to draw on all the best stage classroom management skills I've got to try and get you all working. So let's start with a couple of activities. You ready? Did you just put away your mobile phones? Can you take them out again? Who has photos on their mobile phones? Who has photos of friends or family on their mobile phones? Who doesn't? Who, if you don't have a mobile phone, who has photos in their possession immediately of their friends or family or loved ones? Okay, so in your purse or in your wallet. So what I'm going to ask you to do, very simply, is imagine your students and you're going to show your chosen photo to the person sitting next to you. And that person is going to ask questions. But not any questions. They have to be yes, no questions. Yeah? Questions that the answer is yes or no. So we're going to demonstrate this. I'm going to find a photo on my phone. Okay, we'll need the microphone. And I hope there's no feedback here. Okay, Natalia, there's my photo. Can you ask me yes, no questions about it?
Is this your wife?
It's not my wife, no.
Is it your friend?
More than a friend.
Okay, so...
Don't worry, you're not getting any dangerous ground here.
Is it your sister?
It's my sister.
And is it your nephew?
It's my grandnephew.
Grandnephew. Mm. Are they at the seaside?
I think they are, yes.
Is it in New Zealand?
It's in Australia.
Is it Australia?
No, good, oh. Good guess.
All right. Was it taken in winter? In autumn, sorry, autumn.
It looks wintry, doesn't it?
Mm-hmm. Winter, really?
Well, for Australia, it's wintry.
Okay, summer for some countries.
You're doing
was
great.
Was it taken this year?
I think it's taken fairly recently, by the age of the little boy.
Okay. Good. Were they on holidays?
They were on holiday indeed.
Isn't it enough, no?
Give Natalia a round of applause. Thank you, Natalia. Okay, so you've got the idea. So can you take out your photo, find the photo, and then when I give you the signal, off you go, and then change, yeah, after you've run out of questions. So about half a dozen questions, yes, no questions, to find out more information about the person in the photo, and then change, and then I'll tell you to stop. Off you go, now. Can't find one? You can't find a photo? Okay, how are we going? Have we done? Both ways? Okay. Done? Okay. Okay, who's going to share some information they found out about their person sitting next to them? Yes. Okay, listen. So what did you find out?
The picture was taken 3 years ago on 21st of December. It was a farewell party, and all the participants were friends. Some of them are not in Armenia anymore.
Mm-hmm.
And the gathering was held in Yerevan.
And who was the person, or is it a group of people?
A group of people, right. Friends.
Fantastic, good. Yes. And what did you find out about?
She loves the color red. That's why her her children were wearing red.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Okay.
And they were at a theater, the puppet theater in Yerevan. And her husband and her father was with them, were with them.
Fantastic. Did anybody find somebody sitting next to them a photo that you recognized, that you knew the person? Somebody was telling me yesterday, last night at dinner, Armenia is such a small country that everybody is related and knows everybody. So if you do this, there's a good chance of the person sitting next to you. Oh, I know that person. It's my cousin's uncle's wife. I come from a small country too, New Zealand, and we have the same problem. As soon as you meet a New Zealander when you're traveling, you start to find out what they know, how related they are. Good. Okay. This is a second activity now. Do you have your very attractive British Council notepads? You mean you didn't bring them, you were given these, and you left them at home, what, to make shopping lists with? Oh, you weren't given them? Oh! I thought it was just me. Okay, do you have a piece of paper on you? Okay. Sorry, Ad. It was in my pack, I didn't realize. Okay. Piece of paper then. We're going to do a little dictation. So you have a pen and paper. If you don't have pen and paper, you can do it on your phone. Okay, I'll give you five sentences. And it's not a test. It's not a test. Don't worry. It's not a test of spelling, punctuation. And we'll see why in a minute. Okay, you ready? Okay, sentence number one. I started teaching when I was 25. I started teaching when I was 25. Don't you love dictation? Everybody like working quiet, concentrating, control, control, complete control. There's 250 people in this room and you're all doing the same thing. I think it's wonderful. Number two, I've been living in Spain for ages. I've been living in Spain for ages. Okay, number three, before that, I worked in China. Before that, I worked in China. And number four, this time last month, I was in Malta. Malta, you know, the island in the Mediterranean, Malta. This time last month, I was in Malta. Malta, M-A-L-T-A. And finally, number five, I once worked as a lumberjack. Lumberjack, lumberjack. What is a lumberjack? What is a lumberjack? A person who cuts down trees. Lumber, an old-fashioned word for wood. Jack, a person who works. Lumber, jack, one word, yeah? Woodcutter. So, I once worked as a lumberjack, yeah? Okay, got five sentences?
Yeah.
Just let's check now. So could you give me sentence number three? Over here. Good, that was number three. Could you give me sentence number five? Okay, and could you give me sentence number one? Okay, and so on. So this is one way of checking, because what's very important is that the students have all got the same sentences. So they can compare. And that shows that it's not a test. Dictation is traditionally done as a kind of test, but I don't think it need be a test. But we'll talk about that in a minute. Okay, so we've got, or we could write them on the board, I could project them. Yeah? Okay, so we've got the sentences, they're all the same. Five sentences, they're all about me. Some of them are true, and some of them are false. So now, this is your test of ability. You don't know anything about me apart from what Ada just told you, but I'll give you a clue. Four of them are true, one of them is false. Okay, so just write T, 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 F, T against whichever ones you think are true or false, yeah? Individually, and then I'll give you a chance to compare and say why. So this is a test of your ability to judge character. It's not a test, really. Okay, one of them is false. Which one?
The last.
Just compare now. Compare. Which one do you think? You think it's on why?
That's just my opinion.
I don't look like. Okay. Let's see. Let's see how good you are. Who thinks it's number one? Who thinks it's number one that is false?
Nobody.
Number one is false, you think. Who thinks it's number two? Who thinks it's number three? Interesting. Who thinks it's number four? And who thinks it's number five? Why? You really don't think I worked as a lumberjack? Oh, well. I started teaching when I was 25. Yeah, it is true. I started teaching when I was 25. I'd finished university. I did one. And then I started teaching. A lot of people started teaching even younger. No, who started teaching here younger than 25? Yeah. Some of you are still younger than 25. I've been living in Spain for ages. What do you think? How do you know? Okay, good, you were listening, yes. I've been living in Spain for 30 years, yeah, so a long time, yeah. Barcelona, yeah. Okay, so that's true. Okay, so it's not one, it's not two. Before that, I worked in China. I worked in Japan. Did I say that last night? Oh, I must have been lying. I've done workshops in China, yeah. I did indeed, yeah, but I didn't mention Chinese, no. Okay, well, let's hold that one, let's see. That one's a bit iffy. What about, this time last month I was in Malta? Possible. It's possible. It is possible, and it's true. I was in Malta this time last month. So I once worked as a lumberjack. Most of you think that's a lie. Okay. Where do I come from? New Zealand. What is there a lot of in New Zealand? Trees. Yeah. What do people do when they finish university and they've got nothing to do and they want to earn some money? They cut down trees. Exactly. I once worked as a lumberjack. It's true. It was. Okay, so China, number three. I never worked in China. Yeah, I worked in Egypt before I worked in Spain.
Do we get any prizes?
So, okay. Any questions you want to ask me about that information before we move on?
How about Malta?
Malta is fabulous, and I'll be talking about Malta again after the break.
Why do you live in Barcelona?
Why do I live in Barcelona? Because of the football. Where's Anoush? Yes. Anoush and I both support Barca. Okay, any more questions about any of those sentences? I would love to work in China. Yeah, in another life, I would like to go back to China. Yeah. It's a fascinating country. Who's lived and worked in China? There you go, you see. And you enjoyed it?
I loved it.
Yeah, there you go. You see. Yes.
What did you do in Malta?
I was at a conference, and I gave a talk, and I did some sightseeing, and I ate some delicious food.
What's your favorite?
Maltese food. No, I mean, my favorite, well, I tell you what I had rabbit. Do you eat rabbit here in Armenia?
Yes.
It was very good. It was very good. And apparently it's a typical thing on Sundays. You keep rabbits, but you don't eat them. Good, fantastic, yes. How do I find time to cut trees? Well, I don't do it anymore. I've stopped doing that. I actually love trees, and I don't like cutting them down, but when I did it for about 3 months. It was the most dangerous job I've ever done, apart from teaching children. Really, really dangerous. But, you know, it's nice out in the mountains and the woods, etc. Yeah. Yes?
Did you enjoy your job as a landlord?
Well, I'm just saying, I did and I didn't. It was very hard work and dangerous, but there was a certain romance about it, being in the forest, so you know what the forest is all about. Yes?
Why did self-teaching
carry? Why didn't I? Or, yes. Because I was busy cutting down trees.
Would you?
Oh, now, I mean, what? That's a personal question. What's that got to do with being a lumberjack? You can ask me afterwards. No, I would not participate in international woodcutters competitions. No, it's not really, I'm not cut out for that. Okay, we're doing fantastically. Let's move on. In those five sentences, you may have noticed that very secretly and cleverly I included some time expressions. Ah, so for example, in number one, what was the time expression? When I was 25, exactly. What do we call that? An adverbial clause of time? Yeah. What about number two? For ages. What about number three?
Before
that. Number four?
This time last month.
Good. And finally, number five? Once. What does once mean? One time in the future or in the past? Okay. One indefinite time in the past, yeah? Okay, good. Okay, now, this is for you to do. Now, I want you to choose two of those time expressions for yourself. Two of those time expressions. And I want you to write a true sentence about yourself using each of those time expressions. Two sentences, yeah? Now, if it's this time last month, you can change that if you want to this time last
year,
yeah, if you like. Or with next, this time next month, or this time next year. Okay, so you can change a little bit. Similarly, when I was 25, you can change 25 to 21. If you're not yet 25, you can change it to 65 if you're 70. Okay, so whatever. But you can change the numbers, but use the basic structure. Yeah? So choose two of those expressions. Write a sentence for each expression that is true about you. And don't write anything you wouldn't want to share. Okay? Okay, how are we going? If you've done two, write a third one. You done? Okay. You done? If you've done two, you can start thinking of another one. Let's just hear. Has everybody done two? You've got three. If you've got three, fourth one. Everybody got two? Yeah? Okay, can I hear one of your sentences?
Yeah. This time last year, I was in Israel.
In Israel?
Yeah.
And was that?
Aha,
okay. And was that the first time you'd been to Israel?
Yeah.
And where in Israel? Tel Aviv.
Tel Aviv and... I'm confused.
Doesn't matter. And what time of year was that? And how was the weather?
A big cold.
And how long were you there?
4 months.
A month? Wow. Did you learn any Hebrew? How do you say hello? Or exactly. Okay, good. Fantastic. Sorry, what's your name?
Naira.
Now, you see that little conversation I had with Naira?
Yes.
Yeah. I want you to do the same with your partners. You can work in groups of two or three, whatever's comfortable. So take turns, read your sentence to your colleagues, and they will ask you questions about it, like I asked Naira, yeah? And then change person. I'll give you about 3 minutes on this from now, okay? Okay, where shall I go now? I think I'll go. It breaks my heart as a teacher to stop people talking.
We can't. It's our...
But we have things to do. So who found something out of interest that you think we should all find out about? I'm going to go over there to make sure the front people in the front are always good and work, but I'm going to check that the people at the back were working. So does anybody over here want to tell us something they found out about their partner? Anything interesting? Did you?
Found out.
About the person you were talking to? Yes?
I found out that my neighbor...
That my neighbor was in London 2 years ago.
And what was she doing there?
She was just visiting London.
And did she have a good time?
Yeah, she enjoyed it very much.
Good.
And she visited very many places of interest.
Like?
Like Windsor Castle, and this is the best thing that she has seen there.
Fantastic. Good. Brilliant. So you get the idea? Now I can get the stories from the students about the person they were talking to, the result of the conversation. Okay? And I could do that a few more times. And there's a lot of material there. But I'll come back to that point in a minute. What can we do now with all this wonderful, these wonderful conversations? We could practice indirect and direct speech. That's true. We could make a grammar focus of it. I mean, one of the problems where you've got all this wonderful conversation, it's all flying around the room, but it's temporary. It's not this ephemeral. It's not permanent. How can we capture that? They can write about it, exactly. So once you write about something, it becomes a recording, you can go back. And also, the writing forces a little bit more attention on the form, the accuracy, the grammar, the vocabulary, etc. So maybe one activity you could do is say, okay, in your groups, you've just had a really interesting discussion, you've shared all sorts of things. Now write a summary of that discussion for the student who's not here today. There's always one, no? So, and that gives it a purpose, yeah? And an audience. We're going to write for the student who's not here, so write a summary so he or she can see what they missed, yeah? And then you've got text, they write together, you've got texts which you can use, take with you home, look at, diagnostically, etc. We come to that. Here's another writing activity. This is one that I do a lot, and I would like to demonstrate it with this, but the group is too big, but I'll try and show you what I mean. I'll start it off. Put you into groups, so let's say about four, maximum four, three or four. Yeah? Now, where did I go last month?
Malta,
exactly. So you're going to write an account, a summary, a narrative about my, Scott's, trip to Malta. And the first sentence is going to be, last month, Scott went or was in to Malta, dot, 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 yeah? Now, you're going to write this in groups, but how? Okay, you could do it, but I mean, what are you missing? What do you need? You need information, exactly. How are you going to get the information? By asking questions, exactly. But this is the trick of this activity. You're not going to ask the questions, you're going to write the questions. You're going to write the questions on these little bits of paper. So each group gets lots of little pieces of paper, and they think of questions about my trip to Malta. Meanwhile, I sit here waiting for them to deliver the questions. They bring me the question, so why did you go to Malta? And I write the answer for a conference. And then I give it back. And then another person comes with a question, and another group, and another group. So each group has a post man or woman, yeah, delivering the question. If the question is not correct, what do I do? If the question is a, why did you went to Malta, what do? I send it back. I send it back. I said no. Or if I think it's maybe too difficult for them to correct, I'll change it myself. But it's a good way of controlling the speed of the activity, because if you've got a lot of groups, you're getting a lot of questions very fast. And a very good tip is if you can get colored paper, and each group has a different color, the green group, the pink group, the blue group, so when you're getting the questions, you can know which way to go. Okay, so when they've got the questions, when they've got the answers to the questions, what do?
They write a summary.
They write their little composition. They write their summary, yeah? Now, what do you think is interesting about these summaries? There's this group's writing a summary, this group's writing a summary, this group's writing a summary, and this group's writing a summary. Are the summaries the same? No, why not?
Because the questions
were different. Now, some of the questions will be the same, but a lot of the questions will be different. Questions about food, questions about the weather, questions about how long, questions about transport, etc. So, all the texts will be different in little ways. So what's a nice thing to do then, when they've written their texts? Yeah. To let them share the text, yeah? So this group, move your text to this group. This group, move your text to this group. Or, put the text on the wall, yeah. 1, 2, 3, 4. Students stand up, read the text, move like an art gallery, yeah? And they move around. And they're looking for the differences. What did this group find out that we didn't, yeah? And so they've got a purpose to read the texts. Just as we have a purpose to write the text for the students who's not there, we have a purpose to read the text because the texts are going to be different. Unfortunately, I didn't bring with me an example. I have a lovely example of a group of teenage students, my teenagers in Barcelona, who wrote a summary of a trip I did to Portugal. And it was lovely, and they had all the right information. Now, when they're writing the summary, of course, this is another thing to bear in mind, they have to change things, because if I said the answer to the question, I went to Malta for a conference, they have to change that to he went, yeah? So they have to make subtle changes. And then they have to put the information in a logical order, and maybe use linking devices, like and then, however, and so on. So there's quite a lot of composition going on. It's not just a matter of putting all the answers in order, no. And, yeah, so the example I had where these students wrote about me going to Portugal, and one of the things was he had a lovely time and the weather was glorious. Yeah. Now, where did that expression come from, the weather was glorious? No student ever says the weather was glorious. It came from me, because it was in the answer to my question. So you can feed in language that you think the students might like to use, idiomatic language expressions, etc. And you get these lovely compositions. So that's another way of doing writing in class, which is kind of meaningful and purposeful. Okay. Some other things we could do with some of that material, going back to the sentences, like, for example, if your model sentence in the dictation was this time next month I'll be in Switzerland. This time next month I'll be in Switzerland. Students write sentences using that structure. What have you got? You've got great examples of the future tense, yeah? And some of them may be even very advanced. You say, this time next month I'll be studying for my exam. I'll be studying for my exams. Now you get those examples, put them on the board, you've got real examples from the learners of the grammar, yeah? Real examples. Doesn't mean the sentence in the dictation has to be the same grammar, no. But one of them, maybe you want to focus on. So you can pull that one out, use those examples as your focus for the grammar. You might have to correct them and change them around a little bit to make them okay, but that's okay, that's okay. But the sentences come from the students. And what we were talking about last night, when you personalize things, it's more likely that the students will remember, yeah? Personalization, meaningful memory. And they remember that sentence about Naira, for example, much more than they remember a sentence about a person in the book, I think. Oh, yes. Okay, so what have we got here? Can we just recap the activities we've done? So far, what was the first activity I did with you?
The phone.
The phone, the photo, the picture, yeah? What was the second one?
Dictation.
The dictation of the sentences. Now remember, dictation traditionally was used for testing, but dictation is it's a great crowd control technique, it's true, but it's kind of good for giving, it's practicing listening, of course, but it's also a way of transferring material to the learners, sentences in this case. I wouldn't dictate a whole complete long text, but just a few sentences. Great way. I don't have to put them on the board, I don't have to do anything. And it's good ear training for the learners. But the important thing is that they shouldn't feel anxious about the dictation. It shouldn't be considered a test. They should realize that they're going to share, they're going to correct, we're going to sort it out, there's no problem with spelling, they can ask me questions, it doesn't matter, as long as they've got the same sentences. So we did the dictation, and then what did we do?
We came up with questions.
Well, there was the true and false. There was the true and false, yeah? Yeah. True and false. That makes it interesting. And then you wrote your own sentences using this grammatical structure that we'd pulled out. So now, you can put any grammar into those sentences that you dictate, of course. You can put past tense, you can put future tense, you can put prepositions, you can put phrasal verbs, you can put conditionals, you can put whatever you like into the sentence. But they don't have to be in every sentence. They don't have to be in every sentence. So you can use sentences of stuff that they've done before, and you can pop in something that's new. Okay, so you wrote your sentences. And then you had a conversation, yeah? And you had a conversation which was basically sharing the true information that came up in those sentences. And then what did I do after you'd had your conversation? I got some examples from the students to tell the class what they'd found out, yeah? And then one possibility, which we didn't do, but you could do to follow up, is that you have the students write a summary for the student who's not there. And or we could do the kind of what I call a paper interview, yeah? The interview with the questions, so they write a text in groups about my trip to Malta based on one of the sentences, yeah? How long do you think that would take those? If we did those and I gave you sufficient time, and bearing in mind the writing would need considerable time, how long do you think that sequence of activities would take in a normal classroom? 35, any advance on 35? 45. Depends on the level, of course, depends on how many students you've got. It depends, but you have almost a complete lesson there. How long is a typical lesson in a school in Armenia? Okay, so you've got a lot of lesson time in those activities. Could you use those activities with different levels? For example, could you use those with quite low-level students? Yeah, I mean, for writing the story about my trip to Malta, that assumes that they have the past tense, yeah? So, I mean, but still, because you're giving them the language, all they have to do is write the questions. Then you're giving them the answers. So you can actually do it with relatively elementary students. Now, how would you characterize that lesson in terms of what's going on? How would you describe that lesson? I mean,
informational.
It was informational. What kind of information?
Personal
information. Information about me and personal information about you. So this, again, follows the same thread I was talking about last night. If it's personal, it's perhaps more meaningful. If it's more meaningful, it's more memorable. Of course, there's problems with the personal. And you have to give students the option to pass. If things get too personal, say, no, like, I passed. No, you're not going to know that. That's between me and this lady over here. So if you don't want to go somewhere, you just say no. If the students don't want to go somewhere, say, no, it's too personal. That's okay. That's life, you know. We have to be sensitive. We have to be authentic. But personal, generally, is good. Okay, so there was personalization. Anything else about those activities?
Communication.
People were communicating with each other. I was communicating to you. You were communicating to me. You were communicating with each other. There was a lot of real communication going on, not just practicing language, but listening information that you didn't know. We didn't know that this lady had been to London. We didn't know that Naiman had been to Israel. We didn't know that Natalia didn't know about that I had a sister in Australia. So, I mean, it's all new information. So we're trading information. We're exchanging information. It's communicative. Sorry? Exactly. So it's interactive. It requires management skills that we were talking about last night to be able to organize. But I did it with you. How many people in this room? 250. And you were all talking in English together. Most of you. Okay, so it's communicative, it was personalized, and what about the skills? Talking of skills, what kind of skills were we using? The four skills. What were the four skills we did? We had listening to the dictations. You had speaking, asking questions, talking to each other. You had writing, yeah, writing, if we did all the activities, and there's reading even, if they're reading the text of the different groups. So all four skills are covered. Integrated skills lesson. Anything else about that lesson? So new language came up, could be fed in, that's true. I fed in new language using the dictation, and I fed in new language using the answering the question. So you can feed in new language, good. Anything else about that lesson? What did you say? I didn't use any materials? Are you sure?
No, paper and pen, why not?
No, I didn't use any materials. There was no photocopy. There was no books. There was no dictionaries. There was no PowerPoint. There was no... I what? I was the source. I was the source of the content. And you were the source of the content. How long did that lesson take for me to prepare? An hour, 2 hours, do you think? 3 hours? Look, you want to see my preparation? This is my preparation. I did it over here. While we were waiting, yeah, about 2 or 3 minutes. I had to think of 5 sentences. I had to think of the sequence. And that was it. That was it. That was the amount of preparation. How long do you spend preparing your lessons normally? Well, how much do you wish you could spend less time preparing? Now, listen. This is the point, and you guessed it. Yeah, well, yeah, okay. What we said last night, the expert teacher is the teacher who prepares less but manages more. It's all about management. Now.
And there are also lots of.
Okay, there's lots of improvised, spontaneous teaching opportunities available in that lesson. Now, what I'm going to say, this is it. This is the crunch, people. This is my thesis, if you like. This is my argument. The fact, is it a coincidence that the lesson was interactive, communicative, lots of skills, personalized, memorable, and it also involved zero materials? Well, you know what I'm going to say. I'm going to say, I think it's not coincidental. I think there's a relationship, and this is my argument. And I want to just, so we're going to do a little bit of theoretical stuff now, and then we'll go back and maybe look at some more activities and have some questions, yeah? Can you, this is the theoretical bit. On your piece of paper, just draw a triangle. Any shape, size, but a triangle. Okay, on the top of the triangle, write, on the top point of the triangle, write teacher. On one of the other points of the triangle, write student, bracket, plural, S, students, student or students, yeah? And then on the third point of the triangle, write materials. Now, these are the three elements in any classroom of any subject, anywhere in the world. If it's a geography class in Peru, if it's a math class in Boston, you're going to have a teacher, you're going to have students, you're going to have materials. And you have them in language classes, too. Normally, traditionally, the kind of direction of interaction goes from the teacher through the materials to the students. Very typically, it's like, good morning, class. Open your books. Page 56. Luisa, can you read the first question? Yeah? Oh, yeah. I did 6 years of French at school doing exactly that. Always. Teacher, materials, students. What about the route teacher directly to the students? Now, maybe in some classes, like math classes or biology classes, geography classes, that's a difficult one because the students don't know what the capital of Peru is, so they have to look it up. But in a language class, it's just language, maybe that direct route from the teacher to the students and the students to the teachers, maybe we underuse it. And similarly, the route between the students themselves. So my argument is that we've become a little bit over-dependent on the, what I call the scenic route through the materials, at the expense of the direct route between the people in the room. And so this is the background to this whole thing. When I was a teacher trainer in Barcelona, working with experienced teachers in service courses on a diploma courses for the Delta scheme, we had teaching observations. So I would observe, me and my colleague Neil would observe the teachers. And you'd see the teacher coming, say the lesson would be 50 minutes, 55 minutes with practice students, yeah, adults. And the teacher would be coming down the corridor and she'd have a set of course books. And she'd have a set of dictionaries. And she'd have a cassette recorder. And she'd have a couple of videos. And she'd have a box of Cuisinart rods. And she'd have a guitar. And I'd say to her, Betty, why have you got all these materials? And she said, oh, just in case. I said, just in case what? 40, 50 minutes. She said, no, well, just in case I run out. I said, you're not going to run out, Betty, not with all that stuff. And if you run out, you could just talk to them. You could just talk. And she's going, oh, talk to them. They might make mistakes. No, I go, no. I mean, okay, to be fair, she was being examined. I was observing her. And so she didn't want to run out. But we had... So Neil and me, my colleague Neil, who Natalia knows, decided we were going to get rather tough on these students. And we'd say, no, absolutely not. You cannot be taking in all that material into just a 45, 50-minute lesson. You exactly. Less is more. Take in a little bit and see what you can do with it. And those five sentences that I dictated to you, look how much mileage we got out of them. We got a whole lesson, practically, out of five little sentences that I wrote on the back of an envelope. So we started to say to the teachers, no. And the reason we were saying no, too, is not just because it was a waste of photocopies and a waste of materials, but because we felt that although the teachers notionally subscribed to a communicative approach, so what kind of teacher? I'm a communicative teacher. There was not much communication going on in the classroom. Why? Because the room was full of stuff. It was full of things. It was full of activities. It was full of... Now, okay, I'm not saying that you don't need things. I particularly those of you who teach young learners. Of course, you need to keep them busy, and you need games, and you need cards, etc. But there's times when you get a lot of mileage just out of the interaction in the room, if you can control it and manage it. And if you think about these activities that I just did with you, they are not rocket science, they're not difficult. Dictation, one of the most traditional activities ever in a language class, it's so easy to do. It's very controlled. You know exactly what you're going in with. You've written it down. You can control the students. The activity with the interview, if you can imagine it, it looks a bit chaotic because there's students running around with bits of paper, but actually, it's very controlled. There's an object, there's an outcome to produce the text in English, to do it collaboratively, and they have to write the correct questions or else they won't get them answered. So it's very controlled. It's very easy to do, even in a large class. So there's none of these activities need be chaotic. You need a bit of basic classroom management, and you can get an enormous amount of communication out of minimal means. Less is more, less is more, less is more. So this was in about 2000. And it happened, this is Neil and I were being very, very tough on these in-service teachers. And the lessons were getting better. You could see the light was breaking through. Students were like, oh, this is interesting. We're talking about real things. So coincidentally, I was at a cinema one evening in Barcelona. It was a film from Scandinavia, and it happened to be a film made by a group of filmmakers called the Dogma, D-O-G-M-E movement, Dogma 95. It's a short-lived film movement, but what they were trying to do was what they called rescue cinema from Hollywood. See, the Scandinavian small-budget filmmakers, and they didn't want to make films like Terminator 3 and Titanic 4, and they wanted they wanted to make small budget films without special effects about real stories, about real people that people might know. And they did. And they drafted a set of rules for this film movement. And the first rule was you can only film on site, yeah, and using the things that are on the site. You can't bring in things. So if you need to film a scene where you have a flock of chickens, or rabbits for that matter, then you have to go somewhere where there are chickens or rabbits. You can't dial a chicken and bring them to the studio. They were very tough about this. And you have to use the music. The film has to be performed on site. It can't be pre-recorded or post-recorded, etc. So what it meant was that these films were quite what I would call gritty. They were kind of rough. They were a bit difficult to watch sometimes. It was handheld cameras. But they really affected you. Their stories were very, very powerful. And there was sort of, and I thought, I was watching this film and I thought, yes, yes, yes. This is the kind of thing that we need in English language teaching. So I wrote a little article, which was published in 2000, and it was called The Dogma Approach to ELT. And to use the same principles of the film movement to adopt them into English language teaching. So that the first rule was only use the things that are already in the room or that the students bring to the room. That's a pretty tough order, but you've got your phones. There's so much stuff on your phones alone, the photos, and every student has. So that is so exploitable. We didn't have that in 2000, the case that everybody had phones. So this was what happened. So it was a kind of, I was being provocative. Deliberately, because I felt that we were getting into a situation where we were over-resourced with materials. And the publishers were producing more and more fabulous materials, wonderful, giving them away, testing packs and resource packs and CD and DVDs and then websites and then all the technology. This was came later, all the other stuff, the technology. And I'll be talking about that tomorrow, technology. But so I did that. And almost immediately, I got a response from some teachers around the world who said, wow, that's amazing. I've often thought about that. People say things like, the best lesson I remember teaching was the day the photocopier broke down. Or the best lesson I remember teaching was the day that there was no electricity and I couldn't do the listening. And I remember that. And I think this is where it came from. When I first started teaching, I was 25 and where? New. No. Malta, no. Egypt. Now, Egypt had massive problems in terms of infrastructure. So the power went off every evening regularly. And so what we'd be doing, you'd be sitting there with your cassette recorders, and you get your little listening, and you're ready to play, and the lights go off, and they really go off in Egypt. It's like for hours on end. And so, what did you do? We sat in the dark, and then the concierge, what do they call it, the caretaker of the building would come up with candles, sit in the candle, and we'd sit in a circle with the candle, and we would tell ghost stories. And those lessons were just so memorable and so exciting. So this is a thing I can remember from my experience of having to deal with limited resources, some of the best lessons. And the other thing I used to do quite often when I became a director of studies, I had to substitute for teachers who were not there. And they often didn't leave a lesson plan or anything, or any indication of where they were. So I have to go and say, okay. And then off we go. And I remember, here's another little story. This is when I first realized that less is more was a lesson. I had a group of beginners in Egypt, and they were really, really, you know, there was about 16 to 18 young adults, and they were very, very keen to learn English. They were highly motivated. But they were also frustrated because the syllabus we used was very slow. It was even slower than syllabuses are now. It's like, we're going to get, first of all, we're going to do the verb to be, affirmative. Negative questions, like weeks, and because you had to get it right before you moved on to the next one. Question text, WH questions, negative questions. Now we're going to do the present continuous. Same thing, affirmative, negative questions. Weeks would pass. These students would go through a whole year before they got to the past tense. I mean, you know, how much conversation you can have with the present continuous? Well, you can now because of mobile phones. I'm just walking down the street. I'm just going into the shop. I'm just getting on the bus. But I mean, really, you know, you cannot have a conversation if you don't have the past simple. So I realized how frustrated these students were. So one day I thought, I'll just try something. So I walked in, and I had nothing except the latest cover of Time magazine. Now that was one of, in Egypt those days, authentic materials, forget it. It's very difficult to get. A few international magazines. You couldn't ask the students to buy it because they're expensive. But I had the cover of Time magazine. I put it on the board. I sat down. The students looked at me. They looked at the picture. They looked at me. They thought, he's having a nervous breakdown. Because normally I was at the front of the class, you know, eliciting and drilling and correcting and, you know, and the picture, but nothing. And they looked at the picture and they looked at me and I... And the picture, I can't remember what it was some news story. I think it was something to do with Saudi Arabia and arms, some deal with the United States or something. Not, you know, but, and they looked at, and then eventually somebody said, Saudi Arabia, and looked at me. And then somebody said, guns, or jets, or whatever, and bombs, and somebody said, United States, and then somebody said, And then gradually, they started to reconstruct the story behind the news picture, just basically using words, lexis, yeah, no grammar, just words. But they started to, and then they started to look at me less, and they started to realize that this was, in a sense, a kind of a game to see how much language would come out. And then when I got to the point where, I think we might have exhausted the class lexicon, you know, the shared vocabulary between the class, they'd reconstructed our story, I thought, now what do? I know. So I said to them, listen, I'm just going out. Here's the chalk. I want you to write a summary. You're the class secretary, Ibrahim. You come up and write a summary of what you just talked about. Yeah? So this is the writing stage, capturing all this wonderful language which is floating around the room. So I walked out. I had a cigarette. Those are the days when people used to smoke. I came back in. They said, no, not yet. And the board was already half full of writing. And so I went out and had a cigarette. I came back in. By this stage, and I think, I can't remember, but if I'd been intelligent, I would have said, just write on one half of the board, because I'm going to write my version on this half of the board, yeah, which is exactly what I did, I think. So they had, and they had written a summary, and it was like this long, and it was not perfect. These were beginners. It was very ungrammaticized. But it was material that they'd produced themselves from their collective consciousness. So all I had to do was say, okay, right. Yeah, I think this is what you're trying to say. And then I would write my version here. There's not correction. It's like what I would call recasting or reformulating. I'm putting into native-like language their initial attempts. Yeah, you get what I mean? So I'm not saying, oh, this is wrong, this is a mistake. No. This is what you're trying to say. Listen, this is a nice way of saying. So I filled the board, and they wrote it down, and that was the end of the lesson. And what did it teach me? It taught me exactly that. Less is more. First lesson. Second lesson, trust the students. Trust the students. They will come up with something. If you're not judging them. So we started this, so people started to contact me saying, yeah, that's really interesting, I've been doing that too. And so we started a discussion group online, and for people to share ideas. And here's one that came up very early on. This is a teacher teaching in the Middle East. He said, and he had a group of his weekend students, and they have an exam next week in which they have to write an informal letter. And so this is how the lesson went. And he describes it like a lesson plan for a diploma course. Stage one, get the students to look at the sample letter in the course book. So there's a letter, an example. And then we analyze the language. We analyze the language and style together. Group two. Stage two. The groups discuss informal letters, noting the various features of informal letters, yeah, linguistic, vocabulary, etc. And then stage three, I thought, what am I doing? He puts that like 2 seconds. He said, I opened my diary and found an email from my brother-in-law. I ran to the photocopy room. I ran back out of breath, and we looked at a real informal letter together, again, noting the style, content, etc., in pairs as a group. Students wrote letters to me for their homework. The result, yesterday I received 18 of the most wonderful, genuine, honest pieces of writing that I've ever seen, expressing thoughts about the course, their families, their love lives, etc. And he adds, real people writing about real things. And he says, what did I learn or remember from this experience? A, keep it real. B, humanity is wonderful and we have the best job in the world. Don't we know it? Give and you shall receive. So, I mean, I thought this is fantastic. This is this teacher who'd been teaching 6 months and it's his first job, and he was discovering that if you trust the learners, that you can get an awful lot from them. So this was the kind of quality of stuff that we got on the website. So without going into the history of that, the website is, in a sense, folded. I mean, it's still there, and you can go back and look at it if you want, see all the thousands of postings over the years. It's kind of migrated now, this whole discussion, into blogs, etc., and people are doing different things in different ways in different contexts. That's great. That's fantastic. I'll be talking after the break a little bit more about the kind of dogma as a method. Is it a method or not? It was called dogma because that was the name of the film movement. It's not a very good name, because it sounds like dogmatic. And so immediately people said, oh, you're just being dogmatic. You're just, you know, being prescriptive. So we tried to change it to teaching unplugged with by analogy with the music movement, exactly, playing without technology, etc. And after about 10 years of a lot of criticism, but also a lot of enthusiasm, I mean, I'll just give you one more flavor here of, this is from another teacher, who said, it became more than just a technique. It became something that teachers did for personal, professional development. And one teacher said, at this point, dogma becomes a brilliant platform for personal growth, because in trying to understand my students, I learn about human beings in general. And this search for understanding has given me a reason to learn about areas I never had the patience to learn about before. So, I mean, it became quite a big agenda, and this was interesting and very encouraging. But there was a lot of criticism. People said, nah, you're just trying to stand. Nah, you're anti-course books. Nah, you're anti-this, you're anti-that, you're anti-technology. Okay, we've got to rethink this. It sounds very negative. So Luke Meddings, who was one of the first people who got involved in this, and I decided to put a book together of ideas and a kind of philosophy. And we boiled it down to 3 principles, which I think were already mentioned. First of all, teaching unplugged or dogma is all about, about conversation. It's conversation driven. Yeah, it comes out of the conversations that you create. So you've got to create the conversations. 2, it is materials light. Not materials zero, but materials light, not heavily dependent upon materials or technology. Because if you have that heavy dependence on materials, you don't get the conversation. And the 3rd point, which I haven't discussed really, although it's come up, is that it deals with the language that comes up, the emergent language, not the language which is in the syllabus, pre-selected, but the language that comes up out of the conversations. And that's perhaps the hardest part. And the part where you get most criticism about dogma, because if you just wait for language to come up, what say it doesn't come up? What say it's in the exam and it doesn't come up in the class? What are you going to do about it? What about the syllabus, etc.? So you've got a challenge there. But I think it's not insuperable. What happens is that people adapt the principle to their particular context. So if you work in a context where you've got a very prescribed syllabus, You've got exams which test that syllabus. You've got materials that the students buy or given. Then you cannot say, oh, I'm not going to do the syllabus. I'm not going to use the materials. I'm not going to... Yeah, you've got to play by the rules. But within those constraints, it's still possible from time to time to open a little light into the classroom and let students talk about the things that they want to. And that's what we call dogma moments. And if you can just create a few dogma moments, then the quality of the classroom ecology will improve, I guarantee. And you'll feel better, and the students will feel better about the whole process of learning a language. We saw that last night in the example about Jorge and his wedding, and the teacher who ignored the possibilities of talking about Jorge's wedding in Mexico because she had page 56 to do. And that seems to me a shame, a tragic waste of wonderful human material. So that's what all it's about. It's now 3:10, and I think, we'll just have time for 2 or 3 questions from the floor. Shout them out. And as I say, we'll be revisiting this theme after the break. In the next session, I will be returning to the theme of dogma, but yeah.
Okay, I was just wondering what the disposition of course book writers to dogma is. Thank you.
Well, that's a really good question. A lot of my best friends, I have to say, are course book writers. And fortunately, they're still my best friends. And a lot of them say, actually, secretly, that's how I teach myself. Most experienced teachers, and this is another thing that I need to emphasize, there's nothing new about dogma. There's nothing new about it. Good teachers have always been doing this. And in fact, if you look at the research into teacher development, you find that when teachers start teaching, they're very dependent on materials. Stands to reason. Like Betty, just in case. As teachers become more experienced, they depend less on materials, and they become better at interacting with and using the material that comes from the students. So when you talk to experienced teachers, like course book writers, teacher trainers, and they say, yes, secretly, that's what I always do. But, I write a course book for whatever reason. The publishers, when I started blogging about this and going online, the publishers they paid a lot of attention. But they weren't threatened. Because publishing is so big and so enormous, and the exam system, etc., that nothing that little Scott Thornbury is going to do is going to change that. Although, I think some publishers have realized, we need to include more real content in our books. We need to include more opportunities for personalization. We need to include more speaking at the beginning, not just at the end of the lesson. So I think there's been a subtle shift in thinking with some publishers, and I'm grateful for that. So yeah, that's the answer. Any more questions then? Well, I appreciate, yes. Yes, Marina. You probably can get away with it.
Thank you. This is wonderful. And as a teacher, I practice it myself. Just wondering about teachers who are non-native speakers of English, how should they approach this task and pay attention to the kind of language that is generated in class?
That's a very, very good question. And there's a set, we get a number of questions like that. Questions about teachers who are inexperienced, how they handle this. Questions about teachers who are non-native speakers. What's interesting, actually, at the beginning of the one of the first people to post in the dogma discussion group was a Romanian teacher. And she said that the best time of the school year in Romania was the first month of the year because the course books hadn't arrived. So you just did what you wanted to do. And I thought that was interesting, but that came from the perspective of a very, very fluent non-native speaker teacher of English. The reason why you're asking that, I'm intuiting, is that non-native teachers feel less confident about dealing with things that come up, language stuff. And I'm sort of thinking, yes, but actually, native speaker teacher is also very nervous, and actually maybe more nervous, because if you've got your backpacking teacher of English from Australia or from Canada, he's never studied grammar in his life, but he speaks English fluently. And then a student makes a mistake, he doesn't know, I don't know why they made that mistake. I don't know what that tense is. I can't deal with it. So that's one, so they lack confidence because they don't know the grammar. Your non-native teacher, terrible expression, but nevertheless, has certain insecurities as well that they may not be able to provide the most idiomatic, or they might not recognize that that's not exactly correct. We all have insecurities, but I think they balance each other out, I think, if you've got good methodology. And what I'm trying to say is that the techniques that we included in our book, Teaching Unplugged, were all very quite controlled techniques that you can think about in advance. It's not about planning, but it's about preparing, being prepared. So you anticipate. This activity we're going to do is probably going to generate future tenses, because we're going to talk about the next holiday. So I'll need to think about that. I might need to just check in the grammar book, etc. So you can prepare yourself to a certain extent again. But it is. It's like task-based learning. And after all, dogma is really task-based learning without materials. Task-based learning threatens teachers because they think, oh my God, I'm going to have to kind of deal with whatever comes up, and I might not be able to deal with it. But there's ways of doing that. Writing. Having students write things. The activity I demonstrated last night, paper conversations, remember? Paper conversations. So you have your students in a little two or three, they're writing a conversation, a real conversation. What did you do in the weekend? Hands it up. It's like texting. Hands it back. It's writing, slowed down. And the teacher, it's slowed down for the teacher too. The teacher can look and say, I need to think about that for a second. I'll come back and I'll have a look at this one kind of thing. So writing slows things down. And it retains things, and it's a really good way of capturing the emergent language. So don't underestimate little writing activities that you can do in the class, like I've described. So I take the point that it may seem challenging to a teacher who may be not feeling 100% confident with his or her English, but I think it's not impossible. And in fact, I think the non-native teacher has many advantages over the native teacher in that respect because of the superior knowledge of the grammar.